Well, I'm going to go ahead and get started because it's 8:33. It looks like the hallway is starting to empty out. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
My name is Steve Shaver, for those of you who don't know me. I'm the manager of service training for the Mobile Air Conditioning Society. I'm also the technical editor for MACS publications. So for Action Magazine, the MSR, and our WordPress blog. I hope that you find the information that we put in there useful to you. And just as a little selfish side note, if you have any ideas or something you want me to write about or information you want me to include and put out there to our members, send me an email and let me know about it, because I'm always looking for new topics, new stories, new ideas to send out for you. So I'm going to read this speech, this introduction for Tim, and then I'm going to add my own little bit to the end of it. Tim Iezzi is a working technician and co-owner of Iezzi's Auto Service in Reading, Pennsylvania. He graduated cum laude with honors from Elizabethtown College in 2011 with a Bachelor of Science degree in Mechanical Engineering. He currently holds ASC Master Technician certification, including C1, L1, and X1. He's a Pennsylvania State Safety and Emissions Inspector and Licensed Repair Technician, as well as a MACS Section 609 proctor. Incidentally, checking back through the records, when I teach my the MACS 609 class, one of the little interesting things is I looked through the records to find out who was the youngest guy to ever get certified. And that came up because 2 years ago, my son got certified here when he was 16. And I thought, oh, Brian's got to be the youngest to ever get 609. It turns out the youngest was at 13 years old, and this is the guy who did it. Tim and his family-owned shop have been MACS members since 1985, and he currently holds the position of secretary and delegate for AASP Berks County Chapter 23 of the Alliance of Automotive Service Providers of Pennsylvania. He enjoys racing, football, go Eagles, and hockey, and his favorite car is a Superbird. So, just a little side note, Lansdale is not very far from Reading, so Tim graciously allows MACS to come down every once in a while and get pictures. I've done a couple stories on some rebuild jobs that they've done in the shop. About the last year or so, Tim has started teaching 609 classes, and last year he did his first, the 2015 Mobile AC update with MACS. So we're looking forward to him teaching more classes with MACS, and this is his debut class at a MACS event, so welcome Tim Iezzi.
So as Steve said, my name is Tim Iezzi. What we're going to cover today, we're going to start with a little bit of background of the laws of thermodynamics, how it applies to what we do with automotive air conditioning. We're going to explore the pressure and temperature relationships in an air conditioning system and see how we can exploit those relationships for system diagnosis. If we have time, I have some information on electronic variable displacement compressors, because that's what's really changing how we look at our temperature relationships. There's some interesting things in there. And if we still have some time after that, I'm gonna go over with everyone part of my diagnostic, what I do in the first 5 minutes I'm with the car to gain diagnostic drugs. I get a lot of questions about that when I've been teaching my 609 classes. We're not gonna go heavy into the mathematical aspects of thermodynamics. It puts me to sleep, I'll be completely honest. That's not what this class is about. You're not gonna have to start solving equations to state the fixed narrative. So first and foremost, you bring a car into the shop, air conditioning may or may not be working. You hook up a manifold gauge set after you identify the refrigerant, protector, sealer, do everything. And you see these pressures on the gauge set. About 38, 40 on the low side, about 90 on the high side. What's that telling you?
Something in it.
Any easiest way to think about this law is thinking about a brake system. You know, when you come, when you're going down the road, that vehicle has tons of kinetic energy. Kinetic energy is the energy of motion. When you go to stop at that stop sign, you apply the brakes. We change most of that kinetic energy into heat energy through the friction between the brake pads and the rotors. If we've got, you know, cheap brake pads that are squealing, we're changing some of that energy into sound energy. If you're in a Sprint Cup car going into Turn 1 at Martinsville, you're turning that into light when the rotor starts glowing. But none of that energy was lost. It was only changed and transferred. The second one, and this is very important, is the work energy equivalence theorem. The change of energy in the system is equal to the work put into the system. How we express that is Q out. Q is, in thermodynamics, the symbol for heat. It's not H. H is used for temperature. The heat out at the condenser is equal to the heat put into the system at the evaporator, plus the work put into the system at the compressor. Make sense? So if we're going to talk about heat, what is heat? Heat is energy. We measure it in the English system, in British thermal units, BTUs, or in the metric system, the joule. A BTU is the amount of heat energy required to raise the temperature of 1 pound of water, 1 degree Fahrenheit, at sea level. The conversion to metric is about 1,055 joules per BTU. So you think about that as a pot of water boiling. You put that pot of water on the stove, you start putting heat into it, putting heat into it, putting heat into it, eventually it starts to spit and sputter and spool and boil. Every little bit of heat is one BTU. You start adding that heat till it eventually boils. There are also a few different types of heat. Sensible heat. Sensible heat is the heat that we can feel. You know, we can feel the difference in your hand between 50 degrees and 70 degrees. That's sensible heat. Then you have latent heat. Latent heat is more the heat that you can't feel. There are two different types of latent heat. Heat of fusion and heat of vaporization. Heat of fusion we don't deal with in refrigeration because we're not dealing with anything freezing. If your refrigerant's freezing in the system, you've got bigger problems. Heat of fusion is how much heat it takes to change a certain quantity of matter from a solid state to a liquid state. The heat to be added, or heat taken away to change that quantity from liquid back to solid. Heat of vaporization then is how much energy you have to put into that certain quantity to take it from a liquid to a vapor, or how much has to be taken out to go from a vapor to a liquid. Like when you're boiling water, you start raising the temperature of that quantity of water, it hits 212 degrees. You can't feel the difference temperature-wise between 212 degree water and 212 degrees steam. There is no difference. There's no difference in the sensible heat. The difference is the latent heat, the amount of energy that you put into that to boil. Or when you're condensing it, the heat that you're taking out of it to turn it from steam back to liquid.
What you're saying is at that point, if you had a thermometer, you could measure that.
No, you can't measure latent heat with a thermometer. You can't measure latent heat with a thermometer.
Right, at that point you'd stop seeing the change.
You would stop seeing the change. There's no, what you're measuring with the thermometer is the sensible.
It would stop at that point.
It would stop at that point. Okay. You would see no temperature difference between the water and the steam until every bit of that water was boiled.
Gotcha.
So assuming you're doing this in a closed container, mm-hmm. you would see the steam forming at the top, the water at the bottom, until it all turned into steam. Then you would start seeing the temperature increase again.
Makes sense. Thank
you. And if anyone has any questions at any point, just stop me. I'll be glad to answer your questions. three of them that we deal with in air conditioning. So you have solid, liquid, and gas. But then you have the two-phase mixture. You have a two-phase mixture, solid, liquid, when something is melting or freezing. We have the liquid and the solid existing at the same time at the same temperature. And you have two-phase liquid and vapor, where they're existing at the same time and at the same temperature. We also have to make some assumptions in air conditioning. And some of these are very close, some are not. But they're close enough that you can work with them and come to a very close conclusion. The first one, we're going to assume that heat is only transferred at the heat exchange. So we're going to assume there's only heat transfer at the evaporator in the condenser, and if applicable to the system at the inline heat exchange. We're going to neglect any heat transfer through the compressor body or through the lungs. And it's a pretty close assumption. You think about at the compressor, your compressor surface temperature is very close in temperature to the engine compartment air. So there's really not a whole lot of heat transfer that happens. And if your lines are well shielded and well insulated, you really don't have much heat transfer going on there. We're going to assume that there is no pressure drop across the heat exchanger. We know this to be not accurate. But unfortunately, with system designs, you can't always put a pressure cap in every line to measure pressure at every spot. You don't always have a place where you can measure pressure in the discharge line and the liquid line. Sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. If you don't have a place that you can measure pressure in both places, you can assume that it's the same. Not quite right, but close enough. We also make the assumption that you're working with a pure fluid, meaning that the only fluid inside the system is refrigerant, either R12, R134A, YF, whatever it is. Once again, not completely right because we have PAG oil in the system and a little bit of moisture. It's close enough. And if your PAG oil charge is correct, you shouldn't have enough oil coating placed in the system to affect your heat transfer. That's what happens when you have an oil overcharge. You wind up with that oil coating the heat exchangers, coating the inside of the system, and changing the heat transfer properties. It's also important to note that heat always transfers from areas of high concentration to low concentration. It always goes from hot to cold. And really, there is no such thing as cold. We talk about something being colder than something else. Cold is just a lack of heat. There really is no such thing as cold. So, what we deal with in automotive air conditioning is vapor compression refrigeration. Basic system, we start at the compressor. We leave the compressor as a high pressure, high temperature vapor. Go into the condenser. We transfer heat out of the system, leave the condenser as a high pressure, high temperature liquid into the expansion valve. Expansion valve, we pass through an orifice, the refrigerant expands, we have low pressure, low temperature liquid. Pick up the cabin heat inside the evaporator, leave the evaporator as a low pressure, low temperature vapor, and back to the compressor to start things over again. This is a very important tool that we use in thermodynamics. This is called the pressure enthalpy diagram. What you have here, you have absolute pressure on the y-axis. And it's important to note that this is absolute pressure, not gauge pressure. When you look at a manifold gauge set and say the system pressure is X, that's with reference to atmosphere. Absolute pressure is 14.7 psi higher than gauge pressure, atmospheric pressure. For the most part, will be all of the charts that I have and all of the tables that I have compiled are written in absolute pressure. Thermodynamics always work in absolute. You don't work in gauge. Then you have enthalpy on the x-axis. I'm not going to go into what enthalpy is. It's a measured quantity that takes into account the internal energy of the refrigerant. not important for our diagnosis, not something we'll deal with. But what is important here is that we have pressure on this axis. All these lines that come in, starting at the top, go down through them like this, those are lines of constant temperature. What you can plot on this, which you have here, this little curve, that defines what we call the two-phase region. So if you look at this chart over in this region, it defines the part of the fluid where, under these conditions, this set of pressures and temperatures, the refrigerant is going to be a liquid. In the middle here, in this region, the refrigerant is going to be two-phase, meaning you'll have liquid and vapor existing at the same time. Then over as we go further to the right, the refrigerant exists as a vapor. Make sense? If we plot an ideal system on this chart, we'd start here. That's our refrigerant leaving the compressor. High pressure, high temperature, vapor, so we're in the vapor region. We come across, we have a line of, across this temperature line, condense, we're moving through the two phase, just to liquid, leave the condenser, go through the expansion valve, temperature drop and pressure drop. Ideal system, leave the expansion valve as two-phase, liquid and vapor. Go through the evaporator, back to low pressure, low temperature vapor. Through the compressor and everything starts over. Make sense? This is an actual system. I have a saying, there's absolutely nothing in the automotive world that is ideal. So we start here, same deal, superheated vapor out of the evaporator, compressor, very superheated, high pressure, high temperature, through the two-phase, it's subcooled liquid, expansion valve, evaporator. The reason for this being, like I said, we have nothing as ideal in the automotive world. We have too many variables, too many things that are constantly changing. If the system is designed to operate as an ideal system, you have no margin of safety. Meaning, if we go back here, say conditions change, and we don't pick up as much heat at the evaporator as we expect, and you go into the compressor, say here, where we still have some liquid refrigerant. Not all of that refrigerant has vaporized. What happens when you put liquid refrigerant into a compressor? Pistons come out the side of the casing. You have to have some margin of safety to make sure that we're not going to get liquid into the compressor, and that we're not going to have vapor coming out of the condenser. If vapor coming out of the condenser and not liquid, that expansion valve's not real happy. Yeah, that's what happens, why you have poor cooling when the cooling fan doesn't work. You wind up, you have liquid coming out, or vapor coming out of the condenser, it's not all condensed. This is a chart that I took out of all of the charts that I have in this presentation. I took from this textbook. Highly recommend everyone buy a textbook similar to this and read through the section on vapor compression refrigeration. Don't try to do any of the math, but read through it. These textbooks, this version, are going for less than $1 on half.com and Amazon right now. It's an old edition, but the science hasn't changed. Well worth picking up and looking through.
What's the name of the book?
This one is Fundamentals of Engineering Thermodynamics by Moran and Shapiro. That's just the textbook that my professor chose when I was in college.
You were Mr. Moran, right? I just
knew. Moran and Shapiro.
So you're professor?
No, unfortunately not.
One more time, what's it called?
Fundamentals of Engineering Thermodynamics by Moran and Shapiro. I have the fourth edition. They're up to edition 7 or 8 right now. But the science doesn't change in old editions just fine. So what I have here in this chart is they compiled this middle section here, the pressure and temperature relationship in the two-phase region into a chart. We call it saturated liquid vapor. Now look at the two columns on the left-hand side of this page. And remember, this pressure is absolute, so take about 15 psi off of it. What's that look like? Something we've all seen before. Exactly. This is a pressure-temperature chart that you might have like on the back of a recovery machine or something that you use like check your recovery tank for air. That pressure-temperature chart comes from the middle of this region, the two-phase. It's important to note, very important to note, the pressure-temperature chart only applies when you have a liquid and a vapor existing together. That's the only time that relationship holds. Because otherwise, you know, say, you know, pick a number here. I've got, 60 psi, and they're saying temperature is 50 degrees. If we go through here and follow this 60 psi line, look at all the pressures, or all the temperatures, that the refrigerant can exist at, and still be at 60 psi. So unfortunately, for a long time, we've been told you look at the use the pressure temperature chart when you're doing temperature testing. And I'm going to tell you it's not exactly right. I'll show it to you later. We'll come back to this. But keep that in mind. It's only a guide. It's not the absolute truth. A general rule for you, instead of using the pressure temperature chart, or if you're going to use the temperature-pressure chart as a guide, the temperature at the condenser inlet should be higher than what's on the chart at a given pressure, and the temperature at the outlet should be lower. What that tells you is that you have superheated vapor coming into the condenser from the compressor, and you have subcooled liquid refrigerant coming out of the condenser into the liquid. That's a good rationality check. So now that we've gone through all that, let's take a look at a real car. Vehicle that we used was the 2013 Kia Optima. It's a HALA electronic variable displacement compressor. We were fortunate enough in this car that we could measure pressure in three different places, in the discharge, the liquid, and the suction. We had a high side port in the discharge line, low side port and suction line, and there was a pressure transducer that reported to the PCM in the liquid line. This vehicle is also equipped with an inline heat exchanger. That's very important. I found something very interesting with the inline heat exchanger when I was looking at the data. We'll get to that in a few minutes. All the photos in this section are courtesy of MACS. We did this testing in the MACS facility last year. Group shot of those of us over there. So this is our test setup. We have four temp scan thermocouples measuring temperature at various points in the system, the condenser inlet and outlet, inlet and outlet on the liquid line side of the inline heat exchanger, inlet and outlet on the suction side of the inline heat exchanger, ambient temperature, vent temperature. As this is a variable displacement compressor, an electronic variable displacement compressor, we also have a tool measuring compressor displacement, letting us know how far the compressor is being commanded on. That's very important. functioning. You can get back probe in with a multimeter. You can measure duty cycle or something. These are just duty cycle, pulse width modulated controlled solenoids like a fuel injector. And use a lab scope or something that'll show you what the duty cycle is. Okay, so measuring pressure, we have gauges on the triple R machine, measuring high side and low side, and we're using a scan tool to record the pressure data from the pressure transducer through the PCM data stream. That's something, as I said, you don't always have, but if you have a pressure transducer, what I found looking at vehicles, oftentimes the pressure transducer is in whichever high side line the service port is not. So even though you may not have a direct tap that you can measure pressure in every line, you might be able to use a pressure transducer through data stream. So this is the data that we collected with the compressor running at full displacement. Was about 85 degrees in the shop when we were doing this testing. Had 175 PSI discharge line on the gauge set. Had 160 PSI liquid line on the pressure transducer. About 50 PSI in suction line. The system had not been running real long at this point. 163 degrees at the condenser inlet. 103 at the outlet. 99 degrees at the outlet of the inline heat exchanger. 49 degrees at the evaporator outlet. And 80 degrees at the compressor inlet. Center duct temp, 59 degrees. Like I said, this was only about a minute after we started the vehicle. It had not been running very long. Does anything jump out at anyone looking at these pressures and temperatures?
The pressure is absolutely, or
this is all going to be gauge because we're measuring everything with gauge. So when we go to look at the charts to take information off, add 15 psi to these numbers to turn into gauge, to absolute, to make it work with the charts.
Yep. How did you make sure the compressor was at full displacement?
That's what we have. This tool hooked up, you can see we're reading. This tool goes in line, you take the wiring harness off the compressor, plugs in line with a couple of connectors, and we're measuring the duty cycle to be 100%. So they can.
What were the settings on the control panel?
Control panel would have been max pull, high lower. Yeah, max pull, high lower, reserve. The biggest thing that jumps out to me on this data set is look at our temperature drop across the condenser. This was a working vehicle. Yeah, the air worked in this vehicle as a rental car. We have a 60 degree drop across the condenser. Oftentimes we look at that, see a high temperature drop across the condenser and say, well, that condenser's blocked. We have a restriction there. Yet this vehicle's working fine, there's nothing wrong with it. This is very characteristic of vehicles with electronic variable displacement compressors. We've had these vehicles where we've seen a 100 degree drop across the condenser working perfectly normally. Cars with very few miles on it, condenser's not blocked. And it's had to change the way that we think about temperature testing. So let's look at what this information is telling us. Look at some key points. If we look at the condenser inlet, you see we had 175 psi gauge, so 190 absolute, and 163 degrees. Unfortunately, what something you find in the charts, these are called saturation tables, or superheat tables, excuse me. They often skip, like this one goes in 20 degree or 10 psi increments. So you have to, in a case like this where I'm at 190 psi, these charts, we'll go back a few slides here. These charts are compiled from this region of the table. Yeah, you can plot pressure and temperature and find things here, but it's a little bit easier to look at the charts when they're available. So 190 psi, you can see our saturation temperature, the point where we move into pure vapor is the middle of, say, 118 to 125, so about 121 degrees. What that tells us is the refrigerant going into the condenser is big time superheated. We have so much heat to get rid of in the condenser, huge amounts of heat. And you can see we're 160 degrees, that's four steps into superheating. Huge heat. If we look at the outlet though, where our outlet was 160 psi, 103 degrees. Our saturation temperature was 110. So the system is doing what it should do. We have superheated vapor coming in. We're taking all that heat out of it and dumping liquid back out of the condenser. Let's look at the evaporator. We had about 50 psi gauge, 65 absolute, 49 degrees. This is what's interesting. We're in the middle here. Going into the inline heat exchanger, we still have liquid refrigerant coming out of the evaporator. We're right just barely under the saturation temperature. On this particular vehicle, not only is he using the inline heat exchanger as a device to increase efficiency, they're using it like we'd use an accumulator in a cycling clutch orifice tube system. The last little bit of boiling is being done there. Not all of it's being done in the evaporator. I found that very interesting when I was looking at this data.
Do you think that's designed like that intentionally, or that's something that they get for is it true?
I don't know. Yeah, without talking to the people at the design system, we don't know. I don't know if it's just a case of it's designed to do that, or if they're using it as like a margin of safety kind of device. Yes, Steve.
Was that a 134A car or a Wyatt?
This was a 134A car. This was not a Wyatt.
One reason I was asking is because I saw the new Tacoma not too long ago. Mm-hmm. And you know how the big thing with YF is you need that inline heat exchanger to do that last bit of boiling.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that truck doesn't have it. It just has two regular, you know, aluminum lines running from the front to the back. And the only thing I can see that was different is, you know, the Tacoma, the front end of it is so huge. And the air inlet is gigantic. The condenser is like, you know, 4 feet tall. It's huge. So I don't know if they're just dumping so much heat out of the condenser, they don't need an inline heat exchanger. Or
no, something that'd be interesting to look at. Any of your friends at Team Toyota let us get one for a couple of days?
I doubt it. They're trickling around the country. There's not a lot of them.
Okay.
I mean, the only one they had is on the showroom floor, so.
Okay. When they become a little more popular, when they're a little more released, we might have to get a hold of one of them for some test. See what we can figure out.
Anyway,
so let's go. That was what this system does at full displacement. Let's look at what it does on partial displacement. So at this point, we have the system. The system had, at this point, had been running about a half an hour. Still have the same settings, we're still running on max lower, recirc, high fan, but the cabin has cooled off enough that the PCM is turning back to duty cycle on the compressor. Yeah, this is a variable displacement compressor, it doesn't cycle the clutch, we're just turning the duty cycle back. If this was a fixed system, you know, we'd have a clutch cycle at this point. You can see we're running about 42% duty cycle on the meter. See where our pressures are? About 45 and 120. About 110 in the liquid line. So 120 in the discharge, 110 in the liquid line, 42 in the suction, 125 degree compressor inlet, 90 degree condenser outlet, 90 degree heat exchanger inlet, 71 degree outlet, 47 degrees out of the evaporator, 75 degrees into the compressor. 47 degrees center duct temp. So this car is cooling. It's just, we've cooled the cabin off enough and we're running on recirc. There's not that much heat to pull out of the evaporator anymore. Once again, let's look at the condenser. We look. Saturation is going to be about 98 degrees. Yep. Once again, very superheated coming in. We look for 125, about 92 or so at 100 at our would be the saturation temperature at our condenser outlet. Just barely saturated liquid coming out of the condenser. But we're still doing what we need to do. We still have superheated vapor coming in. We still have subcooled liquid coming in. Look at the evaporator out there again. We have 42 PSI at 47 degrees. Once again, so 42, that's 57 absolute. Our saturation temperature is going to be about 49.5 degrees. Once again, we have liquid yet coming out of the evaporator. It's not all boiled off. It's not all vapor. Once again, we're boiling that liquid for the final time in the inline heat exchanger. So as I said before, you know, we're looking at these systems and we have very high, or can have very high temperature drops across the condenser. For years and years and years, we were taught, you know, 40 to 50 degrees drop across the condenser. Any more than that, you have a blocked condenser. You're going to have a clean issue. But as I just showed you, this system's functioning perfectly normal. This car had about 7,000 miles on it. Doing its job with a high drop. So how can this be? It goes back to what I said earlier about ideal systems and having a margin of safety. These systems have to be able to function between very low displacement, you know, these compressors are capable of going down to about 5% displacement, up to 100% displacement. And at all times through the cycle, we have to make sure that we have superheated vapor going into the compressor and coming out, so that we don't send pistons through the case. We have to make sure that we have liquid refrigerant coming out of the condenser and going into the expansion valve. Otherwise, the system doesn't work. So we have to have a condenser that's capable of getting rid of all of that and an evaporator that's capable of picking it up. To be able to do that, where we're going to see those, what we consider a normal temperature drop across the condenser, is going to be at the lower displacements. As we start turning the displacement up, it's going to go higher and higher and higher. So that poses an issue for us as service technicians. How are we going to be able to diagnose restricted condensers? How are we going to diagnose airflow issues? The airflow issue was the exact opposite of a blocked condenser. You have minimal temperature drop across the evaporator, or across the condenser. So how are we going to do this? Anyone got any ideas? What are is you're going to see a temperature out of the condenser that's going to either match or be higher than what's on the pressure temperature chart. That's going to indicate that you have vapor refrigerant coming out of the condenser. That means we're not transferring heat. We don't have airflow through the condenser. Unfortunately, I don't have any answer to what's going to happen if we have a blocked condenser. I haven't had one to play with.
What is the G-sign?
How so? What's your... That's a very valid point. If you start, one thing that we can start doing, and we need to start doing, is building a database of what's normal. Based on, start playing with these vehicles, seeing what you said, what our normal drops are based on duty cycle, and seeing if we have a blocked condenser, we're going to have a higher drop. What I think we're going to see, unfortunately, I have not had one of these vehicles with a blocked condenser, so I can't say definitively. My thoughts on what we're going to see if we have a block condenser is we're going to see the very high temperature drop coupled with a very high pressure drop. That's my thoughts. What I always say with pressure and temperature is if you're only looking at one, you're only looking at one side of the story. You need to look at both sides of the story to get the full picture. So I think what we're going to see, if we go back up here, even at full displacement, our temperature drop, or our pressure drop across the exchanger is minimal. It holds to what I said earlier about we're assuming there's no pressure drop across the heat exchanger. I think if we have a blockage, we're going to see a big pressure drop. Make sense to everyone? Yes, Steve?
That's actually one of the things that they brought up at SAE last on Thursday.
Okay.
Was because we have no data on this.
Yeah.
I mean, no official OEM data.
Yeah.
So it's been posed, who knows when we'll, or if, time will tell, but.
In regards to this notion regarding the duty cycle, looking at that, how many inputs, or which inputs, is it the same for all vehicles, or most vehicles, are required for the PCM to decide what the duty cycle should be? Is it just pressure, or pressure and temperature?
Jumping about three slides ahead of me. That's my next topic, actually.
Okay.
So, as I said, what's brought all this change along is the electronic variable displacement condensers. Or compressors. So, what I'm finding reading IETN and people that come on my shop looking for help. The solenoid controls refrigerant pressure in the current correct case to move the swash plate. As the angle of the swash plate changes, we either lengthen or shorten the stroke. These compressors may or may not have a clutch. We're starting to see manufacturers moving more towards these compressors having a clutch, because since they never actually turn off, they're always running at some displacement. If you have a catastrophic loss of refrigerant, you wind up losing the oil circulation, or you can do damage to the compressor. If you look like on a Chrysler product, like a Patriot or something, there's a little round ring around the low side port that says, do not operate the engine with the system in a vacuum. Run the engine with the AC system in a vacuum, you pull the oil away from the compressor, and you're going to damage the compressor. If the compressor has a clutch, then we can disconnect it. No problems. So as I said, the PCM's controlling this baseline inputs. What are they? This is from last year's convention, from Helen Gutman Service, a list of some of what Volkswagen is using to control the compressor. And if you look at most of these inputs, these are inputs that the PCM has been using for years to cycle the compressor. Yeah, remember, we're not cycling just solely based on a pressure switch anymore. And most of these make sense when you think about it. Okay, high pressure over 32 bar, 464 psi. Yeah, we're going to turn the compressor off, because if we don't, we're going to open the pop-off valve. Makes sense? The blower's on the bubble. Yeah, the blower's off, you don't need a compressor on. Low pressure, same deal. Double nice the evaporator. Not going to turn the compressor on right away at engine start. Makes sense? Running in economy mode. Makes sense? Want to give as much fuel economy as we can, take as much load off the engine as we can. Lower high outs, low outside temperature, high engine temperature. Makes sense? Wide open throttle. We'll kick it. Cooling fan issue. Deal wide open throttle. Coming to a stop, low vehicle speed. Shut the compressor off. Or we'll turn the compressor off if it's pulling too much power. We say it's trying to lock up. All this makes sense when you think about it. This is stuff that, it's common sense. It's what we've been seeing for years. Some other stuff that you might see, what might change compressor feed cycle. Things like if the heater is on. If you turn the temperature up, turn the heater on, there's no point in running the compressor at full blast, getting that evaporator real cold, just have to heat that air back up. So we turn the duty cycle down, then that's less reheat we have to do, and it's more efficient. And that's what a lot of manufacturers are moving towards. Once again, it makes sense. It is important to note that in order to effectively diagnose these systems, you're going to need a scan tool and at least a multimeter that's capable of reading duty cycle, preferably a lab scope. What you're going to be looking at when this vehicle is in the shop mostly is, does the duty cycle to the solenoid make sense given my set of current operating conditions? And is the compressor doing what it's being told to do? If you have no pressure change on your gauges and a solenoid gets commanded 100%, obviously you've got compressor problems. The same as a fixed displacement compressor where the clutch is turned on, you have no pressure change. That's the biggest thing, to be that rationality check. Is it doing what it should be doing based on my condition? Then you can use your scan tool and say, okay, if it's not doing what it should be doing, why? What input isn't the PCM happy with? Then you can say, okay, if the PCM isn't commanding the compressor on, you can go in and use your bidirectional controls, if they're there, and see if you can command the compressor on. That just checks your whole circuit for you. Just like slight differences in what we're doing compared to a fixed displacement system. But it's nothing earth shattering. It's not as complicated as most people make it out.
Do you find DTCs to be common associated with system performance issues, like inputs?
The vehicles I have seen, I have not.
They're all different.
Yeah, different
manufacturers are going to be way worse. Like Cadillac will set, you know, a plethora of codes, but your manual HVAC system on one of my Sonics or Sparks or something, not so much.
The biggest people that I've seen problems with the variable displacements on, I do a lot of Volvo. And 3.2 V6, like the X90s and the S80s, we've replaced a number of X90 compressors. Some of them have been clutch issues because Volvo does run a clutch compressor on their electronic variable displacements. I've had some that have had internal failures. Either I've had a bunch. I haven't taken any apart to see if I had a swash plate failure or a solenoid failure. Most of them, I think, have been solenoid issues. And what I did was just, it was like I said, I had no change on the gauges, but I had a command. No DTCs set anywhere in the car. The car didn't know there was a problem. Other than no cold air out of them.
With which software, though? That's the other thing. Roadblock you're running. You're not running that Vita software as opposed to, you know.
That particular vehicle, I do have access to Vita. I was probably using AutoLogic.
Yeah.
I tend to go back, on Volvo, I tend to go back and forth between Autel and AutoLogic. I find them just much more user friendly than Vita is. And Vita sucks, to be honest. But it is important, like you said, though, when we're dealing with these systems, to have that capable scan tool to get into the HVAC controls and be able to see any code, see the data set, actually into bidirectional controls to make our life easier. So let's look at, now we have all this information, what brand, car comes into your bed, AC doesn't work. What's the first thing you do?
Me, I'm going to open the hood and see if the compressor's on or not, if it's engaged.
Okay.
That's probably the first thing I'm going to do.
Okay. Do you do anything? Now, you're a flat grader, obviously. Do anything while you're pulling the car into the shop?
I'll see if you check engine lights on.
Okay. And what's the first thing you do when you pull a car into the shop? The air didn't work.
Verify the complaint. Turn the thing off.
Amen. Exactly. Step one.
Step one. Verify customer complaint. That's when I pull, when I have any vehicle, that's step one. When pull, have a car with an air conditioning complaint or a heater complaint, same kind of diagnostic procedure. When I walk out to the car, hit the key in the parking lot, pull it into the shop. I'm going to go through, as I'm pulling it in, I'm checking my blower speeds. Do I have all my blower speeds? Do my modes work? If I move the temperature door, do I feel some temperature change? Obviously, okay, I'm doing a no heat. I'm not going to feel hot right away after the vehicle's been sitting overnight. But you should feel some difference if you swing from hot to cold. If I don't see a mode change or something like that, I know I've got a problem inside the dash. Could still have a problem outside under the hood, but I know I've got a problem. On a no cold, pulling in the shop, it's not being cold as I'm pulling in. My first step, and it's a good first step to make as your habit when you're dealing with air conditioning, before I do anything else, I open the hood, I check the fluid with a sealant tester, and I check for purity for my refrigerant identifier. I want to know that refrigerant is pure, and I want to know that it's not air contaminated. Reason I do those first? So if it fails either one of those tests, if it's got sealer in it, we're not going to move the refrigerant identifier. And I don't hook any equipment up unless I know that refrigerant is pure. Not risking contamination. So there's no point at that point, if it's not pure, or there's sealer, there's no point in going any further because I'm not going to fix the car anymore. Not going to hook my equipment up to it. After we know we're pure, then we'll get to a brand, say hit the key, is the compressor running? Is the belt there? Is the clutch engaged? Hook up my manifold gauge set. Do I have a pressure change? Start feeling the system. Yeah, we do a lot, but all the testing that we did in on these vehicles, we did with thermocouples. For a first quick check, your hand is more than accurate enough. Is my suction line cold? Is my discharge line hot? In those first few minutes, all you're looking to do is gain diagnostic direction. If my suction line's cold, and I'm not making cold in the cabin, I know I'm headed under the dash. No point in doing a whole lot more under the hood. If my suction line's warm and my compressor's cycling, well then I know I've got low refrigerant charge, I have to do a leak test. Same thing with the no heat. Start the vehicle, let it run. Are my heater hoses hot? Is my coolant full? If the heater hoses are hot, or warming up as the vehicle's running for the first few minutes, once again, I know I'm going under the dash. In 5 minutes, you know where you're headed with this vehicle. That's the biggest thing. Make the most of your first few minutes. You know, some of you guys, like, I assume you're mentioning Cadillac, Chevrolet. I assume you work at a GM dealership?
You could go that far, yeah.
Okay. So, GM's paying you, what, 3 cents an hour? Diagnostic under warranty?
It's variable, but it's somewhere in that ballpark, yeah.
So still, yeah, you gotta make every minute count.
Absolutely.
And the more information you can gain in the first 5 minutes, the less time you're gonna waste and the more to the point you're gonna be.
So why didn't you put a scan tool on this? A buzz white line, speed line.
Nice to meet you. Thanks for the slide.
Yeah, no problem. I mean, the class I did last year, we went outside and did practical and showed the scope patterns and the parameters coming out from the vehicle. Mm-hmm. If you stick your, we did a sort of class yesterday or the day before. Diagnostics is now down to, there's no set process. Mm-hmm. You do what you feel like. Mm-hmm. Some people stick a scan to it straight on. Myself, if I've got a fault code, I know where I'm going. I can also pull up parameters straight away, so I'm not in complex equipment to connect in, and most modern vehicles will show you refrigerant pressures, cycles, whatever. And you can usually deduce from those parameters that you see on the scan tool where you might go.
And that's a service to
confirm the.
No, I'm gonna agree with you on a higher vehicle.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
No, you're absolutely right, because I'm there is no percentile lazy I would leave up another scan.
Yeah, I absolutely do not disagree with you guys on hookup scan tool checking for fault codes and taking a look at the data set. The majority of the vehicles that I see in my bags were normally for air conditioning, were normally looking for a leak. So if I do where I had at that point though, I would hook up a scan tool is when I pulled the vehicle in the shop, I have my gauges on. And I see I either have no clutch engagement, no pressure change on the gauges, or warm suction. Something that leads me to a control problem in those first few minutes. Then I'm going to head that direction with the scan tool, start looking for a control system issue, or start looking for an air distribution issue. Like I said, my process is I'm going to spend the first few minutes figuring out what part of the system I need to go further on. Because let's up there and turn it back the other way. If I've got a clutch that's cycling, and low pressures that would indicate when the clutch is cycling that I have a low charge. There's not really a point at that point to connecting a scan tool and looking for compressor control circuit codes. I can see the clutch is being engaged, so I've got a functioning control system.
On the converse of that, though, with a variable displacement compressor with a low charge that can compensate for that, I don't even pop the hood, I don't even hook up gauges, I can hook up my scan tool and get you within the ballpark, but within the first couple of minutes, just reviewing bids.
That is certainly a valid point with the electronic variable displacement compressors, because that is an extra piece of information that you need to know is what your compressor duty so close. That is certainly very valid.
But as the vehicle part changes from what we know as air conditioning systems today, then you know CO2 systems, they don't even condensable.
Yep.
You know, they don't call them condensers, they call them coolers.
Yep.
And that's certainly going to be
a huge change as we start seeing those make their way into the market.
Yeah, anybody work on vehicle reviews? Anybody do vehicle reviews? I-vehicles? I-3, I-8, yeah?
Not yet,
no. Read up on vehicle, it's got a control, it's not only controls the, well, you have a heat anyway, it's going to produce heat. You've got a heat pump in there,
of course.
It produces the heat. And you've got a purity cycle, and you've got the battery thermal management to contend with, as well as the vehicle compartment. So.
Very, very interesting.
That's a yes, it's genius, really. Yeah. As well, opposed to separate subsystems for every.
Yeah. And if the air condition doesn't run, usually the temperature to use the vehicle. It's not easy to push that. I think I need a couple of
better. You push the transfer forward actually better,
yeah.
Yeah.
And that,
sorry, I didn't mean to.
I appreciate the information there. And that's the point that you make there with everything being so integrated is another very valid point that air conditioning is no longer just for passive compartment cooling. That we are doing things like active cooling with it. And with that, you have, as you said, you know, if you have an air conditioning problem, that can lead to a battery overheat issue, which has to be able to. Just to show you, in our modern vehicles, everything is so integrated. Everything has to work together. Mm-hmm. There's no such thing basically as just being an air conditioning guy. You have to be able to do more of everything. You have to also be a diagnostic. So, do we have any other questions? That's about the information that I have for you, as we have questions.
Yeah.